Hello and welcome to How to Win the Lottery, Episode 8, Ducks, Newburyport, by Lucy Ellmann. I'm Joey Lewandowski.
And I'm J.J. Abrams, author of the Superman flyby script.
God damn it. Bob, you had one. I started recording the podcast, and then it became 3 minutes of me reading a Wikipedia article aloud about the movie Superman flyby, because Bob mentioned it. So we're like, oh, who was going to be in that? I'm like, just don't mention Superman flyby. I'm sorry, not Bob. J.J. Abrams, my co-host on the podcast, was just like, let's talk about my film Superman flyby that was never made.
It's really just because I want to talk about the OC all the time.
Do you want to tell your favorite OC joke, or is that not...
Yeah, sure. The best joke in the entirety of the OC is in season 3, there's a female stripper, and she's dressed up like a cop, and someone asks her name, and she says her name is Sipowicz, which is the name of Dennis Franz's character from NYPD Blue.
Which is very, very good. Well, JJ, what is Ducks, Newburyport about?
It's about 1,100 pages. I was occupying the ghost of my father entered my body to tell that joke.
I'm watching the Friday the 13th movies now, and they're doing jokes in part 2, and they're like, what's brown and sits on the piano?
What?
Mozart's final movement.
Oh, that's a good joke.
That's a good joke.
Yeah.
So that's on par with your 1,100 pages joke.
That's a little better than my 1,100 pages joke. The 1,100 pages joke is just like every time you ask an old man what something is about, they tell you the length for some reason.
You know, that's a podcast joke, and then I told the movie joke. Different medium.
Okay.
But what is the content therein describes what?
It is a book in which I think form is its own content, which is to say that the book has a lot of stuff happen in it. It's a book that traces the stream of a single woman's consciousness through very, very many things that all like sort of define modern day America for someone who might be a housewife in Ohio. But really what the book is about how you can capture the way someone thinks and put it on the page.
Yeah.
Does that sound accurate to you? I mean, I don't, like, that's my take on it, but I don't know if that's, you know.
Well, I think what we talked about with Owen Meany, when we're like, what's that about? Like, it's either about faith, or it's about a whole bunch of things, or it's about everything, right? Like, it depends on how you want to break it down. And this is, at its core, if it's about one thing, it's about motherhood, right? Or maybe humanity. There's that book, The Medium is the Message, right? Like, this is written difficultly and difficult to parse and difficult to get through by design. And I think...
it's very dense.
Yes, because the structure of this, it is about 1,100 pages. I think there is a glossary because there's a lot of abbreviations in here that they detail at the end. So it's more like 1,000 pages, I think. But aside from probably about 50 pages, maybe, of like very concise, succinct prose describing a cougar and her two cubs, it's like 950 pages, single sentence, no line breaks, with some exceptions, no paragraph breaks, one sentence, just stream of consciousness in her brain. What is it like to be inside someone else's mind, basically?
Yeah, and it is incredibly repetitive.
Yeah.
Which is to say, probably a quarter to a fifth of all of the words in this book are the fact that.
Yep.
Which begins almost every, not sentence, but...
clause?
Yeah, incomplete clause.
For the purposes of what we're doing, they're basically sentences.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's the fact that this, the fact that that, and then whatever, whatever. And then there's other repetition. I don't remember why, but I just Googled this, and there's a thing on The New Yorker called Can One Sentence Capture All of Life?
Yeah.
Because this is, you know, it's about everything and whatever. And there's also another thing in The New Yorker that I read about is literature now currently, I guess probably a couple of years ago, whatever, too tied to the present? Because this is, and there's another theme that we've kind of talked about this season, especially as we have had newer books, but this feels by design the most modern book that we've done.
Right.
Like, Death in Her Hands is newer than this, but it's kind of taken out of time. And Pizza Girl is newer than this, but it's set in the early 90s or whatever, right? Like, this is the one that feels like, oh, we're dealing with, like, the Trump of it all.
I think Pizza Girl is set in, like, 2016.
Oh, right, 2012 or whatever, yeah. Yes, not the 90s.
The early 90s.
I'm watching Brand New Cherry Flavor, and, like, the setting is just early 90s. Like, there's, like, yeah. a Chiron at the top. She's like, early 90s. So I just have early 90s in my brain.
Did I mention that I'm watching The OC? And
you have.
And that's the early 2000s, so.
But this is set in 2017, so it's, like, probably when she maybe started writing the book, possibly?
Maybe, yeah. Well, what's important about it being set in 2017 is that it's after the election of Donald Trump.
Yes, and after he's in office and, like, actively doing things as president.
Yeah, so a lot of this is a reaction to that stuff, the way that a suburban white lady would react to.
And when he was elected, it felt for a while like the world fell apart. Nothing made sense anymore for a second, right?
And I regretted my vote for him immediately.
You voted for the candidate of your choice. I had a moment of, like, I don't want to call it clarity, but I'm like, look, this is going to inspire 4 years of amazing art that people are so angry and they're so just confused and they're going to express this. And then not only did that not happen, but, like, art got worse and people were just, like, overtly angry. And, like, but I had a moment of just, like, this is going to inspire such great things. And it didn't. It inspired, like, something like this, which, you know, I'd rather that didn't have happened and we just didn't have this book or whatever. But I think what this book serves as, in a very specific way, is a great representation of what it's like to be a woman in 2017, to be an American in 2017, to be a Midwesterner in 2017, and to be, like, a chicken farmer. Because it's like, she's just, you know, I don't want to say, like, there's no, but she's, like, a normal mother, normal woman, whatever.
Yeah.
But she's at the cross section of, like, every major or many major societal things that are going on, in a way that feels natural and organic.
Yeah, I think a lot of that is due to the like scaffolding and the work that she takes to pad out what are extraordinary events within the text with just, like, banalities.
Yeah.
Right? Which is, I think it probably is a difficult entry point for people. So I think a lot of people, when they pick this up, they see the format and they see the density, like the huge dense blocks of texts. And I think when reading it, they probably around page 200, if not page 50, you think, what the fuck is she getting? What is she getting at?
Right.
What is this? Why is she doing this? What's the point of any of this? And I think the point is to meticulously list the banalities of everyday life and juxtapose them with the more traumatic things of everyday life, because everyday life is in its own way kind of traumatic, right?
Yeah.
And we have to find that there has to be a balance between the two things, the banal, the mundane, and these things that you know, as she says over and over in the text, I'm broken. We have to find a balance between shit that really bores us and shit that would, like, destroy us if we let it.
Yeah. And what this book also does, without the metaphor that we both loved, but in You Shall Know Our Velocity or Sacrament or whatever we want to call that book, one of the things that we both really liked about that was the librarians, right? Like, remembering traumatic events and, like, thinking about other things. Like, the librarians, like, knock, knock, knock. Here's an idea for you to think about. Like, remember this horrific shit. This is, again, you know, her husband is a professor, so he makes a good living or whatever. As you know, as a professor yourself, you're the rock stars of the industry.
We're all millionaires. We make more than $23,000 a year, almost definitely.
It's why they're like, yeah, you can buy your own school supplies because we pay you so well.
Yeah. Well, he's a full-time professor, so at least he's getting, you know.
She seems to have, like, a fairly successful bakery business, right?
Yeah, that she left her own teaching job to do because she couldn't handle teaching anymore.
So much of this is just her, like, recipes, like, thinking of recipes and baking things and watching movies while she bakes and thinking and worrying about her kids and whatever. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, it's like, oh, that time that I was sexually assaulted, or that time that my mom, like, fell into, like, a pile, like, you know, the illness that her mother had, or, like, the anal cancer that our narrator had, or on her sit me down upon.
Uh-huh.
it does what Sacrament did in a very, again, natural, organic way, where it's not librarians bringing it up, but she's just, like, thinking about things or, like, looking on a computer at, like, headlines or whatever, thinking about Trump, and then all of a sudden just like, oh, yeah, my mommy died.
I think, like, possibly whatever, like, repetition and franticness of – I don't know if it's necessarily the character, the frantic whatever of her brain, because I think, like, all brains function frantically. If you were, like, to do a transcript of someone's brain, it would be like –
oh, it would be a nightmare.
But the way that this book presents it, like, she does seem frantic. She seems, like, scatterbrained. She does seem like all of these things, because that's, like, the aesthetic way that Lucy Ellman is deciding to put this stuff down, which is meant to maybe bury the trauma from us so that we don't always see it, so that it's not always there, that she is, like, thinking all of these things as a way to run away from the trauma that she feels, and it just comes out. And she's, like, her saying mommy all the time, like,
is weird.
It bothers me in a weird way.
Yeah, mommy and daddy.
Something that I did think of a lot when I was reading this was, this is going to make me feel like a jerk, kind of. You're in your 30s, lady. Like, you have a kid.
Yeah. Four kids.
Parents die.
Yeah.
You have to, like, you have to be able to keep going and not be, quote unquote, broken. Because, like, that happens to everybody. Not necessarily when you're in your 30s, but, like, everyone's parents die. And he can't break you if it, you know, but, like, again, it's not my position to necessarily judge.
Well, that's a theme that we've talked about a couple times already, mm-hmm. like in Sacrament and a couple other things about just the arrested development of it all. But I think what's interesting about this, and then I want to go back to another point you were saying earlier that reminded me of something, but I think she's presenting to the world as a normal, successful woman. And because yes. we're in her head, it's like, oh, right, no, we're all broken by everything that ever happened to us.
Okay, so do you think the point is that everyone is like that? Or do you think that it's just like she has a specific amount of trauma that is...
I don't know. I genuinely don't know. I did think it was weird. I made a note of it, that calling them mommy and daddy. And she says, like, especially mommy in particular, yeah. like a lot. Like, her mother's death really seemed to have fucked her up.
Yeah.
And it seems strange to have a grown-ass woman with, like, real stuff happening to her and four kids of her own to be like, oh, yeah, well, then my mommy died.
Yeah, and she just, there are single, like, clauses where it's just her saying, mommy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was annoying.
I think that was the one part, I mean, there's a couple, I think this is a remarkable book. I think that this is, so you've read this book twice this year now.
Twice this year, yeah.
Which is insane. And I do want to talk about later, because you said you were glad that you did to a certain extent, because you were picking up on things, and I'm sure I can kind of guess things.
It's a book that rewards rereading.
I would guess most books probably reward.
Well, I think good books do.
Yeah. But I want to go back to what you were saying about the, you know, tamping down the trauma mm-hmm. of it all by just the banality of everything. At a certain point, I'm like, stop telling me about school shootings and whatever. And, like, I know that's the point of it.
Yeah.
But it's the opposite of what she's doing with her own trauma. It's like, and then this boy shot his sister in the head because she wouldn't give him the TV remote. And then this boy went to school and whatever. And, like, it's really, like, I don't know how you read a thing like, because I think, to a certain extent, I think we have to. Because if we didn't, we would all not be able to move. But, like, you desensitize to all the shootings because there are so goddamn many of them.
Yeah, I think what you're talking about is functioning twofold. Number one, it's a commentary on the way that we live in the world, where every day there's a new tragedy and we think about it, right? Yep. We think about it analytically. We think about it in a way that where we get used to it. Mm-hmm. And because if we didn't, like, if we spent every... Like, when Newtown happened, right, that was, like, a gutting moment, and it was, like, it was awful, and you feel, like, I remember driving home, I was driving home from North Jersey and listening to, like, that on the radio when it was happening, and I remember just, like, feeling, like, terrible.
Yeah.
And I, like, personally don't have the endurance to feel that way every time
right.
that one of these things happens, because right. they happen once a week now, it feels like.
And it's not only that, like, it's not only the school shootings or a guy at the mall, but she's also bringing up all these instances of, like, a guy murdered his wife, mm-hmm. or a guy murdered his wife and their kids, or yeah. whatever. And it's like things that don't make the headlines because there's so much other horrific shit happening, but there's so much of that. And I don't know how, again, coming from our liberal elite coastal towers or whatever, I don't know how you read a book like this and not be like, where are the gun control laws? Because like, it's just like, I know that's the point of it, like to just like, we need to do something about this, but it's like, it's so overwhelming. And I know that's the point, but it's just like, yeah. at a certain point, I'm like, I don't want to read this anymore. Cause like, this is not a fun book to read.
No.
By any stretch of the imagination. Mm-mm. I think it's really well written. I think what you said to me weeks ago or whatever, like once you, like you, there's certain times where you get into a rhythm.
Of yeah. how yeah, she's writing. Yeah. You can disappear into it.
And there's certain points where I'm just like, oh, like everything, this is like, I don't know if it was the way I was feeling, the way she was feeling when she wrote it or whatever. But like there's chunks of this, like 5 or 10 page chunks. I'm just like, I'm highlighting everything on the Kindle. I'm just like, yeah. this is amazing. At a certain point, like not only is it like it's physically draining to just read something this dense or have the audio, like a 45 hour audiobook, mm-hmm. right, read to you. But then it's like depressing on top of that. Like it's overtly like exhausting and depressing. And it does feel like a triumph to finish this, not only because of the length, but because of the density and the subject matter. Even though, like, in terms of the actual events that happen in the book, there's maybe, like, 4 things?
Yeah. Let's count them.
At the very end, there's the intruder, which we'll talk to, with the gun.
Yeah.
Stacy runs away.
Yeah.
They're at the mall when the parking deck collapses.
And the house on fire drifts down the street.
Yeah. yeah. And I think there's one more maybe, and like there's the cougar stuff, but like so much of it is just like memory or like, oh, they have to do this, like kind of prepping or whatever. But, you know, 1,000 pages, like 4 things happen, right?
Yeah.
And so, I don't know if it's 4, but it's like, it's a very,
sure.
it's well, a very well, few.
Let's go through those things one at a time. What do you want to talk about first? Do you want to talk about the mall?
I think that's the first thing that actually really happens.
Okay. So what happens? What happens at the mall?
So they stop at the mall like while they're delivering pies, and there's like a flash flood, and there's a crummy parking deck that collapses, and they all get trapped there.
And they watch a cat jump in the water and maybe die because the cat is trying to escape from a house. And they watch a house catch fire and I guess become unmoored from its foundation and flow down the river. So they're watching in like a book that is very realistic. There was like this surreal, like almost painterly moment of a house with, you imagine, fire billowing out the windows, drifting down a river.
Right.
What's that about? What is, like, what is it?
Well, I think what was interesting, like I wrote down about halfway through my notes, I just wrote down action, a ramp collapse sure. at the parking deck in the mall. Cause like this is probably 400 or 500 pages into the book until like something actually physically happens, seemingly in real time. And what was interesting to me is that it immediately then kicks off a whole like 10 or 20 page thing about like doomsday prepping and the apocalypse. I think what we were talking about, like with you driving, listening about Newtown, like it just like the one thing happens, which is horrific. And it doesn't, I mean, it happens to them, but not really. Like they're going to be fine.
Yeah.
But it then is the only thing you can think about for a while.
Yeah. It's also, I mean, it's, you know, it's climate shit, right? It's like her becoming occupied with like one of the other major things that we need to really like think about now. We have these shootings and stuff, and we have like authoritarian governments, and then we have this other thing that is like not necessarily a function of politics, although I guess it kind of is, but like climate change, which is like the indifference of nature toward the natural world, where it can just like, it will murder you.
Well, there's like, and there's other things that are tied to that, like all, like I think that's why setting it in Ohio, like with all the rivers and all the big companies polluting and getting away with it.
Sure.
And then there's the big agriculture and big industry of like big chicken, basically, and like her ever increasing number of hundreds of billions of chickens eaten per year, and the sexual assault that she deals with, like basically all of the plagues and the traumas and the horrific stuff of our time is happening to her or has happened to her, or she's in a position to be able to comment on it.
I think I may have, when you talk about the sexual assault thing, like what specifically are you talking about?
There were two things.
Something that I know she had her friend Kathy that she dealt with, her friend Kathy dealt with sexual assault, but like what, did she deal with an assault?
So at one point, again, they were very minor, but they happened like close enough together that I was like, oh, maybe this is going to become a thing. And like, it kind of got dropped. But she remembers going out on a date and the guy basically trying to rape her and doesn't. And then it's just like, so how about a second date?
Is this like he's like an Italian guy, maybe?
I don't remember.
I think there's, yeah.
But there's that. And then she remembers back when she was 10 at a museum and a grown man had an erect penis like pressed into her back.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just like those like little things, like we just said, any man, right? Which is like much more overt about that one thing because that's what that book's about.
Yeah, for sure.
But this is just like, as though being a mother of four and running your own business and dealing with Trump and this and that is not enough, you're also repressing or remembering or whatever just the casual sexual assault that, like, every woman has to deal with.
Well, yeah, because this stuff is all, like, I think we have to view all of this stuff and her focus on all of this and her memories on all of this through the filter of her, like, also functioning as a mother, right? Yeah. So now that she is, like, thinking back to these things and she's thinking of her dad chasing that guy or looking for that guy that pressed his bone into her back at the museum, she's now thinking of like Stacy and her other kids in the context of like throughout her all of her experiences, which is why she's so like gung-ho about, you know, the self-defense books and things like that,
which again in an Owen Meany-esque thing comes back in a big way, which we'll talk about at the end. I think the one thing this book that Lucy Ellmann tries to touch on that she, I don't want to say fails, because in like 1,000 pages, like you have enough time to talk about whatever you want to talk about, because it's just like, there's a lot of words here. But I mentioned this to you, and we don't really talk about it, but her first husband was a Native American, is an indigenous person.
Yeah.
What's the correct term?
I believe the preferred nomenclature is American Indian, actually.
American Indian. So her eldest daughter, Stacy, is like half American Indian.
Mm-hmm.
They kind of hint at that sort of stuff, and they talk about like a genocide at one point, but I feel like it's a thing that seems to be in there for a reason that they don't that she doesn't explore enough.
Well, yeah, I think it is just like a, like, look, this is the history. Like, America has this violent history.
Yeah.
It's like the Nagahonset Massacre, right, or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Or I may be pronouncing that incorrectly because I don't have it in front of me. Where they have a number of soldiers or like vote on whether or not they should kill all the people there, and almost all the soldiers vote to kill the natives, and they do. And she like talks about bringing her classes to a museum so that they can talk about that, and then bring the kids there so they can talk about that. So I think it's just like a way to like look at America's violent past and then again juxtapose it with the violent present.
Because the way that I was able to, I like that, and I think that is another way to look at it. I think a good way to look at it, maybe probably better than the way that I looked at it. But I was also thinking about it just like, it's not her story to tell in a way, because she's not an American Indian.
Yeah.
She married a man and had a daughter who identifies, or like that's part of who they are. And Stacy brings it up a couple times. And like, even when she runs away, I think she like wants to maybe like live with her people or whatever, or like just not be in Ohio at least anymore, right? Like feel connected to something else other than Ohio. And so I'm thinking like, it feels like a theme that could be explored, but this is just like a suburban white lady. And so it makes sense that she's not thinking about being like that kind of person because she doesn't have to deal with it.
Well, she's also viewing it through the prism of whiteness, right? She's viewing it through the prism of like guilt and why don't we talk about this more? And is it my place to talk about this? And, you know, the sort of things that cause her to spiral out.
Yeah.
And like touch on a million different things before getting back to whatever her original point was.
Right. Also at the, when the ramp collapses, going back to that for a second, they call Ronnie, who is their chicken feed delivery man, who comes and rescues them. Because basically everybody in the mall has the same idea. Town's that way. Pretty goddamn far, but like, what else are we going to do? There's no cars can get out here. We're going to walk. So it seems like be this like mass exodus from the mall down the highway.
Mm-hmm.
Ronnie comes and gets them.
And Ronnie is a gun enthusiast. She paints him as being fairly dumb, right? He doesn't know that Paris and London are two different places, and he thinks that you can drive there. And he is obsessed with other people being dumb. He's obsessed with how the police are dumb, how nobody knows how to drive. And he also loves Trump.
Of course he does.
And he's upset with... Or he would be upset that Stacy is wearing a shirt that says super callous, fragile, sexist, racist, Nazi POTUS.
Which is amazing.
Yeah, that she made herself.
They blacked it out in the school yearbook picture.
Which is ironic a little bit because my own personal high school blacked out a kid wearing a Trump t-shirt.
Really?
In his graduation photos. Yep.
But yeah, Ronnie will come back. We'll talk about Ronnie more later. There's also, it's not a thing that happens in real time, but another thing that, like, she, I think, goes into more detail about the actual ins and outs of is getting stuck in the snow in her car.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
and
yeah.
Almost being, but that's years ago. Mm-hmm. And, like, there's the joke that she makes that you don't know why it's a joke, but she's like, yeah, there's a funny joke that I was saved by Jesus. And it's just like, what are you talking about, lady? But it's just because a guy named Jesus, Jesus Lopez Perez of New Philadelphia, saved her.
Yeah.
But, like, that's the kind of thing where, again, it's just like what could have been an absolutely traumatic, horrific, could have died moment became just a funny story or whatever, right? Is the next thing that really happens, I guess, the cougar, kind of, or Stacy? Because the cougar's in.
Well, let's
out.
Talk about the cougar as a separate thing.
So Stacy runs away.
Stacy runs away.
And it had been sort of previewed for, like, a couple hundred pages that, like, she wanted to go to Arizona for college or something.
And one of the major themes is of the book is the tension between Stacy and the narrator, right?
Right.
As teenagers do, she has a lot of, I don't know if it's resentment, but she's sort of judgmental of her parents.
Yeah.
And her mom is trying her best, but she can't seem to get through to her daughter, who wants to confront her about everything from her carbon footprint to her white privilege to all sorts of things of this nature.
Yeah.
And it's a huge source of tension between them.
So much so that they go to family therapy in the book.
Yeah, which seems like Stacy seems to be a good kid, honestly. She doesn't seem to want to embarrass her mom. She stands up for her mom, or she like, when the mom is in family therapy and is embarrassed and has nothing to say, Stacy fills the space with talking because she doesn't want her mom to feel like she's an idiot or something. So she's a kind kid.
Yeah.
And she just wants to get out, like a lot of great kids do. They just want to leave home. They it's not for them. Ohio is not for her, the same way that I'm sure, like, New Jersey wasn't for me.
Until it became again.
The same way that California is not for Seth Cohen in the OC.
But it almost, like, it sneak up, her running away sneaks up on you because it sneaks up on the mom. And because we're so in the mom's head,
yeah,
that, like, just like Stacy's not, like, around. And then she goes up to the room and, like, finds a note or whatever. And she's like, oh my God, like, right. How long has this happened? And right. Like, the husband, like, is not around, like, he's off on a trip. And just, like, panicking or whatever, he's not there or whatever. And eventually, you know, like, the next morning, or no, he's not at, for the end. He's just at work or whatever. And the next morning, just Stacy comes home with her sleeping bag. It's just like, oh, yeah, like, here's what happened. Like, I tried to go, didn't really have a plan, got picked up by I was hitchhiking, you know, I got picked up, I slept in a car or whatever, and, you know, everything's fine.
Yeah, I mean, like most kids who try to run away, they realize that it's like, that shit is really hard.
I remember.
It's hard to be someplace.
When I was in Little League, a kid on my team ran away from home, and I was like, oh my God. And, like, somebody's just like, oh no, he runs away from home all the time. I'm like, oh, so it doesn't work. Like,
yeah, you can't really run. It's very difficult to actually run away from home.
Like, I think he lived near the baseball field. He's just like, and just, like, ran the other way.
Yeah.
And it's just like, he's just being moody or whatever.
Right.
So, you know, I guess she was more successful than the kid on my baseball team. But, like, again, she could have died. Like, things were fine.
Hitchhiking when you're a teenager, you can die pretty easily.
Even though we find out that she is more than capable in defending herself.
Yeah. I'm trying to think if there was something else that I wanted to say about that relationship between Stacy and her mom and the tensions that exist.
Well, I think there's more of a relationship described between them than any of the other three kids and the mom, right?
For sure.
Because of the fact that she's the oldest
mm-hmm.
and probably the most contentious.
And she's not Leo's kid. So there's that. She has the attention of, like, you know, she doesn't see her dad.
Right.
She is resentful of her mom for, you know, for, among other things, not asking for her permission to marry Leo. The mother-daughter tension that exists there is something that you see, like, her running away is, the scaffolding is there. You see it coming because it's one of the major themes of the book, and she goes through it over and over again. So once it comes, it's not a surprise, but it's also, because of the way that the book is shaped, it's not something that you necessarily see coming.
Well, I think it's because anything that actually happens is a surprise. The fact that something happens is a surprise.
Yeah.
Because there are, you know, we've mentioned it, but there are, like, like repeated references to just, like, her thinking about Harrison Ford movies because she's watching them or thinking about them or whatever. And just her, like, oh, I really like that actress. Or is that the other actress? Or, like, whatever. And it's just in her brain thinking about whatever, or just recipes or things she has to buy or things she has to do or whatever, or just, like, worries about this guy. And then, oh my God, Stacey's not here.
Which is interesting, too, because it doesn't, when Stacey's not there, it doesn't necessarily happen. She doesn't narrate that stuff. You have to piece together what's happening by her reactions, which still include digressions within them. So, like, she's not, it's not like it happens. She's like, I found a note and here's everything that's happening. Like, she like finds a note, she steps on a toy truck.
Djibouti.
Yeah, you have to deal with her like reacting to that, and then her just being like, oh my God, what's happening. So you don't really know what's happening. Right. You're learning it as she like is reacting to it, while she never straight up tells you exactly what's happening. You have to kind of like figure it out.
It was funny, and funny is the wrong word, but at the end when there is the shooter in their house, and she's still, like, thinking about movies. I'm like, lady, fucking focus.
Well, that's a reflection, because it's a reflection, because we get the stuff up until Ronnie comes back in the house with the gun. And then there's a departure. Then we go to the Cougar. And then when we come back, we're a week or two in the future.
Are we?
And she's remembering the shooting.
So that doesn't even happen in real time.
No. No, I mean, it does up until Ronnie comes in the house with the gun, and then we should jump forward, and then she remembers back. So when she's remembering it, that's when she's putting all this movie stuff in between, because it's like just a part of her natural thought process is recalling the events of this day.
Right.
Reliving trauma over and over again.
So yes, you spoiled it. Ronnie is the shooter.
Because he's their guy that delivers their chicken feed, and every time he delivers their chicken feed, he kind of hangs out of the door and talks, and the narrator wants to get away from him, but...
It's too nice. And it's too societally, as a woman, you can't, like, be mean or whatever,
but right? She also doesn't invite him in. She doesn't offer him coffee. She doesn't offer him a pie. And when he comes into the house with the gun, he feels as though she's been dismissive of him, but he also feels as though she's a prick tease.
Yes.
He thinks that she has been flirting with him when really she's just being the polite. Bare minimum of polite.
Right.
But Ronnie is, a maladjusted guy. So he sees her being polite to him as both flirtation and as a brush off.
Mm-hmm.
Which, like, gives you an insight into Ronnie's head. Like, it can't really be both of those things,
mm-hmm.
right? But he sees them as those things because those are the two things that motivate his actions. Both of those things at the same time create a dialectic that allows him to become the person that he can act in the way that he wants to act, because, like, he has these aggressive impulses that he's not denying of himself, which have to do with guns, which are obvious. Like, guns exist as phallic symbols, which, like, represent sexuality or failed sexuality, virility or impotence, depending on how they're used. In this case, probably representative of impotence, because Ronnie feels like he has no power in the world, right? Which is the bill that we've been sold for Trump's success for a long time, right? It's about economic anxiety and the decreasing power of the white working class, which is what Ronnie is. So when Ronnie like has this opportunity to showcase power to a liberal woman who is like the source of many of his like grievances
and fantasies,
yeah, but both of those things at the same time. It's like the people on the internet who are incredibly pissed off about Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez because she makes them horny.
Yeah.
Right? Like these guys who are just like, I'm extra mad at her because she's pretty, but also like has the opposite opinion of me. So I'm going to tweet at her instead of one of the many other people that they could tweet at who don't create that dichotomy within themselves.
I mean, he's emblematic of like incel culture, right?
Yeah, which, like, honestly, like, that has become a theme this season in the, like, we've been talking about that a lot in the books. And I don't know if that's because it's something that I think about all the time because it's the world that we live in now. So, like, I'm seeing that in things, or if it's just always been a theme and now we can put a name to it.
I think there's always been fragile male egos at the center of stories, but I think for a while it was just like, isn't that guy quirky and neurotic? Like he's like a Jesse Eisenberg type or whatever. And then now you see it. Now you're like, oh no, that's actually real toxic. I think it's probably just it's.
Are you saying Jesse Eisenberg is an incel that's going to kill people?
Hey, man, he made Facebook. What can I say?
All right. Yeah, Jesse Eisenberg does play those characters. And he was so mean to that one girl that was interviewing him during the Now You See Me thing. Google it.
True. I saw both those in theaters.
Yeah, the second one, which is bizarrely not titled Now You Don't.
Right. Dumb. Not you. The title.
Yeah, I got that. I didn't think you were calling me dumb. But if I did, I would shoot you.
But I think those types of characters, those types of roles, those types of stories have always been here. It's just that we're looking at them differently now because, like, instead of just giving them a pass or being like, oh, yeah, like, this is, like, I can relate or whatever. Like, I really wish that girl liked me. I'm going to get mad at her or whatever. It's just like, oh, no, like, that's bad.
Yeah, yeah.
Also, we're mostly reading more modern, like, not all, like, brand new stuff, but, like, mostly modern literature where, yeah. like, or progressive authors and whatever. But I think what works well about this final act reflection, whatever, is, again, in the Owen Meany sense, but, like, less magical, right? More practical, which maybe fits the sort of Midwest, like, the type of story it is or whatever, as opposed to about faith and miracles. It's yeah. just about, like, the practicality of everyday life. But Stacy reading the self-defense book comes into play. The ugly floor lamp that she's thought about, that she's mentioned that she hates this lamp. Having apples and flour, bags of flour, and these, like, really fancy pots and pans around all come into play. All in a way that, like, the pieces are all there for this resolution to this, like, crazy event. And you don't see, because there's just so much that's said and so much that's thought and so much that's just there that, like, any number of things could have wound up in the finale, but, like, it all sets up in a way. And I was wondering if that's, like, the kind, are those the things that you picked up on that rewarded more the second time?
Yes. Or yeah. So,
it's
so
the it's the foreshadowing.
Yeah. So the repetition of themes becomes more rewarding when you can, from the beginning, immediately recognize them as themes. So when you have 1,100 pages of this looping, repetitive thought process, it takes like 500 pages or so before you're like, okay, like these things are things that keep coming up and I have them. So like then you have to go back and rethink the first like 500 sure. pages. So like when you start from the beginning already knowing what those themes are, then it's like you can pay closer attention to those themes from the beginning, I think.
You might not be able to hone in on the specifics of it, but I think it's what she does well is that really quickly she establishes as like a modern thing. And so like you're able to just like as a person alive in the late 2010s, early 2020s, you're like, these are the things that like, I know that are probably going to come into play, right?
Yeah, yeah,
so,
yeah, yeah.
But it's the specifics that I guess, yes, would reward mm-hmm. rereading.
When Ronnie stops paying attention, he shoots the kitchen.
He's reloading, yeah.
Shoots the kitchen timer and he's reloading and Stacy attacks him, hits him with the lamp, knocks him to the ground. And then the whole family attacks him.
Yep.
They start hitting him and kicking him. And
throwing apples at him.
And the son kicks the gun underneath the couch.
Tie him up with the husband's clothes.
Yeah. And it becomes this climax in which this thing that she's been ruminating over and over again, which is the presence of right to carry men, the ubiquity of shootings, mass shootings, her children being in danger because of people with guns, worrying about all of these things over and over again, comes to a righteous conclusion in which she has to then confront this thing happening in her house.
Yeah. All the while we're reading this, there's also the story of this cougar with her two cubs, which is running parallel, simultaneous, whatever. There's like basically 50 pages of like her thinking and maybe like 5 pages of the cougar or whatever. And as that story progresses, it becomes clear that like, oh, this is basically in our narrator's backyard. Like this is like not only in America, not only in Ohio, but like around her house.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually they adopt the dog and the dog like goes and pals around with the cougar. And it's just like, oh, so now I know why. Because I think the metaphor and the comparison would still be effective even if they never crossed over. Because it's like the same kind of motherly instinct, but sort of one in not passivity, but just inaction kind of like the mundanity. And then like literally life or death every single day because we don't have the, you know, benefits of society around us or whatever. Right.
Yeah, I think also it doubles as, you know, the animal, which is all instinct and all movement and mm-hmm. action versus the human who is all like neuroses, right? It's like yeah. the differences between action and thinking.
And so when that crosses over, I was like, oh, and maybe it was just a lucky guess, but I was like, oh, there's probably going to be like a shooter at some point.
Oh, okay. That
in her life. Mm-hmm. Because like I think the big theme, if there had to be one theme, it's gun violence, I think, is the thing.
Yeah. Also, cancer too. I mean, that's something that we haven't talked about all that much, except right. for the stuff with the, you know, when I was criticizing her for using the word mommy instead of like mom or mother or something.
That is a big thing, but it's also something that's already happened to her. And I feel like it's less dramatically intense, and I don't know if that's the right phrase or not, but like if she goes to the doctor in these thoughts and it's like your cancer has returned, then it just becomes like this kind of slow burn.
Well, okay, so this is actually my major problem with the ending of the book.
The Ronnie stuff.
Yeah, because the Ronnie stuff functions very much in the way that we, like a traditional narrative functions. Like she's setting up all of these things so that it'll pay off. But the realism of the thought process that we go from the beginning of the book until the end of the book, where it's just like mundanity juxtaposed with this horror, but the horror exists at a distance, right? The reality is that for most of us, that horror always exists at a distance.
Right.
And so the tension is never released.
Right.
The book releases that tension for us.
Yeah.
Like we realistic or not, we assume that she's not going to eventually then die in gun violence.
Right.
We assume that her kids are going to be okay because they get through this circumstance. I don't want that. I don't think that we need to end on this note that also ties it up and sort of in a way repairs her relationship with Stacey.
100%.
I think that feels superficial to me. In a book that otherwise feels so realistic, we then move into this realm of like, it feels like, okay, now we have to tie everything up in the third act and connect the themes in a way that makes sense sure. for a book, and not in a way that makes sense for reality. Because like I said, most of us deal with this mundanity, but we don't get the catharsis and trauma of survival.
Right.
Right. We just have the trauma of looking at it from afar.
Well, I think there's two ways that I will devil's advocate that. Number one, why not her? Like, why not you or me? Right. Like, why isn't somebody that I pissed off at some point you knock on my door right now? Yeah. Like, because I think it proves a point that it could happen to anybody. That in her head, like, maybe she's never thinking this could happen to her. Because, like, when she hears of her friend who had a friend who got shot or whatever, she's like, oh my God, I can't believe that happened to somebody I know, because it's just surrounding her. And so like, why not her, right? Like, I think there's that element of it that just, not that people are feeling complacent or whatever, but just there's the very real threat that like at any point in your life, someone that you are casually related to or you don't know at all could end your life because they're having a bad day or something, right?
Yeah. Well, my answer to why not is because it ties the story up too neatly.
Sure. The other thing, and this, again, isn't going to necessarily counter that point, but sometimes when watching TV shows, it's like, why is everything happening to these six characters or whatever? It's like, well, because that's happened to somebody. And like, just why not them? You know what I mean? So like,
I think like that's asking the wrong question. The actual question
probably.
Is like, the reason we're watching these characters is because yes. these things are happening yeah. to them. It's not like the camera just like absentmindedly went to these four people and then was like, let's see what happens. It's like, we've decided that these things are going to happen, and then that's why we were telling this story, yeah. because these are the things that are happening.
Well, because it's kind of like, specifically like with Lost, right? Like there's like 40 survivors of the plane crash or yeah. whatever. And like, and they even like kind of make jokes about this, that like all the crazy shit happens to like half of them, and the other half, like, we just never meet. And it's like, wait, is nothing happening to those people? Or like, we just, or is equally crazy shit happening to them? They're just not the people we're following. And we don't know. You know what I mean? So.
Yeah. It's like how in the OC, like Ryan is always getting into fist fights, and it's just like, dude, you can just not punch people and stop lying.
It's so easy not to punch people.
Yeah.
It's easier to not punch somebody than mm-hmm. to punch somebody. So the cougar, and anything more to say about the cougar? I think there was a moment when the cougar's cubs get whisked away or like rescued mm-hmm. by the do-gooders who like find them, because like the mom goes away to get food.
Yeah.
And there's like a storm, and like the cougars get like washed, like the cubs get like washed away, or like they're like in a weird kind of spot or whatever, and she comes back and they're not there. That was like maybe the saddest I felt all book. I'm just like, oh no. Because like she's just being a good mom. Like she's providing, and then just.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was a bummer.
It's just this idea that like you can be doing the best, and it's just, you know, things conspire to fuck you over.
There is also some like crazy shit that the cougar encounters. Like the cougar sees a man kill himself. Mm-hmm. The cougar also oversees a man with like a zoo of like 50 endangered wild exotic animals. Like, I don't know if I like zoned out for a second or it just like was meant to be kind of surprising.
Well,
but there's a scene where it's basically describing like, it's just chaos and dudes are shooting exotic animals. I'm like, where are we? And we don't know for like maybe like 100 pages and like a couple like, you know, then the narrator is recounting like, oh, she read the story about this guy who like went crazy, but he owned the zoo of all these exotic animals. And the cops are like, we have to shoot all the animals or whatever. But we see it firsthand from the cougar first.
Yeah.
And also like another thing that kind of bothered me about this is like the cougar both knows everything about humanity and like human words. And it's just like, you know, trains like those big metal snakes. I'm like, you cannot call them big metal snakes when like you know the word for like everything else.
Yeah, that's weird.
But like the cougar sees this like absolute chaos, like what looks like Vietnam. And I'm like, what happened? And we eventually find out, but I'm like, where, what is this?
Yeah, I love stuff like that.
That's cool.
I love being, yeah, being jarred out of something and then learning later. I will say, like you said that you may have zoned out for a little bit. I think this is a book that you zone out to.
Yeah.
I think that if you read this book for 1,100 pages, I think there are going to be large chunks of it that you just like move through via osmosis. There's going to be large chunks that you don't remember at all. And when things happen, probably vital things that are vital to the plot, vital to, because of the way that it's written is meant to like lull you into not realizing what's important to the plot.
Right.
So like, I think that the length of this book and the repetitious hypnotic way that it's written, you're meant to sort of just like, you know, fade out on.
I read like the first 600, like actually read, and then I listened to the last like 400 or whatever in the audiobook. And this audiobook, we, you know, for as much as I kind of trash the Owen Meany reader for his like weird Owen voice, like this woman, this was like, I think she did a great, I think she was a great ebook reader, audiobook reader, right phrase. But I was like, you know, like 150 pages left in the book, and I was listening, and like I fell asleep, and like I woke up in a panic. I'm like, I don't know how long I've been asleep.
Yeah,
that's or how to find where I was. Uh-huh. And it was less than a page. Like, it was just like, oh, I just like, I think I like nodded off and like woke up like in a panic. It, you know, at one point you're like, where are you in the book? And I'm like, oh, you know, she's talking about motherhood and baking pies. Because like, there's no way to find.
Yeah. Anything. Oh, the 9/11 joke she does is really good too, about like making a 9/11 cake, and then she's like, but why would anybody want a 9/11 cake?
Because she has a pan that's a 9 or something, right?
Yeah.
She's like, yeah, if I get like a 1, then I can do like a 19 or a 91 or 9/11, but like also like, so there are a few things that I think you don't necessarily pick up on if you're just listening, but like as you read it the first time, like there's like the number pans are like huge block letters, like huge block number, not letters, numbers. They're numbers. They're not letters. They're numbers.
A number is a kind of letter.
Is it? They're math numbers, math letters.
Yeah.
But then there's a part where it's like the certainties of life, because I think this is after the apocalypse and like the whole like, we could die at any moment.
Like, oh,
I think
she's realizing this. Like, poetry thing?
Yes.
And you've got like 40 pages or something that's like...
And like her certainties of life are all things that like, very not certain.
Yeah. Well, like, the same way that like after she says the fact that a lot of things are not remotely facts.
Yeah. Anything else about the book?
I think I'm good. What do you want to... are we going to call Matt?
We are going to call Matt. I'm just seeing if there's anything else. Cherokee Tracker, Harrison Ford movies, Saved by Jesus. Oh, one thing she does a lot, which I really, really like, because I think I do it too, not as often as she does, but she'll be like, I don't know if I'm going to have an example of it, but it'll be like...
the grammatical thing?
Yes. Where she's like, Bob does this thing, and then my dad, and he's sick. No, not my dad, Bob, but also my dad too, maybe.
But why is she... That's another thing that feels superficial for a book, because like you would never do that correction in your brain.
Well, that's another thing... that in one of the New Yorker pieces about this, it's like that, I don't know if it was meant as a criticism or just like a, like, why is she correcting herself?
Yeah, it's a recognition of audience. It's, right. It's like the postmodern idea that like you're presenting artifice in order to remind people that they're reading a book.
How does this compare, a book I have not read, but you sort of vaguely told me about that I think we'll probably read on this podcast at some point, but Megan Boyle's Life Blog. Is this like that at all?
No.
Is it similarly stream of consciousness or just it's totally different?
Totally different.
Okay.
Totally different.
All right, let me call Matt. Is this bedtime or do you think this is after bedtime?
No, this is, it should be after bedtime. I don't know.
Hello, you are on the air with How to Win the Lottery.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
Hey, man.
Have you gotten over the fact that you accidentally benched Colton Wong? Or you benched fan mail for Colton Wong?
Yeah, it's all good. I'm in a holding pattern for the next 36 hours, so I lock up this first round bye. So I'm feeling pretty good.
You're in a wonderful position to be, as unlike me and Bob, who got knocked out of our contention a long time ago in fantasy baseball.
So is the league bleeding into this podcast as well?
No, not really. I still think my favorite moments of Tub Talk were you giving NLCS recaps 4 months before the episodes aired.
Yeah.
Oh, the Brewers just tied it up.
Archival content.
So Matt, we're talking
where you win moments.
Matt, we're talking about a book called Ducks Newburyport. I just texted you the art, the cover art. This is, of course, the segment Judge a Book by Its Cover by the Honorable Judge Matt Erdely. Court is now in session.
Yeah, got me in a good time. I'm cleaning out the basement.
So this is This is after bedtime. We're imagining, right?
Yeah. My parenting duties are done for the night.
So now it's basement cleaning time.
Yeah.
I like this cover a lot. Oh, we didn't even talk about the title. We'll talk about the title after we're done with Matt, or maybe on the phone with Matt. I like this cover a lot. I don't think this at all really hints at what this book is.
Yeah.
Yeah, this almost is a design that looks like it would be like a, you know, when they do like series of books and then there's like a kind of a templated look.
Yeah.
That final, it almost looks like that.
Like two colors with an object in the middle or something.
Yeah, a lot of flat color, something that looks like a variation of Futura, you know, kind of that Wes Anderson aesthetic going on.
It does, yeah.
I mean, what's interesting is the illustration, because I can't exactly tell what that is. It almost looks like one of those, eye puzzles, where it's like it could be two things, because it's obviously a duck. But I don't know, it kind of looks like maybe a whale cresting, too, or an iceberg of some. Actually, now that I zoom in on it, it's pretty much just a duck.
I'm holding the phone so that Bob can see the picture, and I was like, oh my god, this is something I never even, and then like as soon as I turn around to look at it, you're like, oh no, never mind, it's just the one thing.
yeah, real pretty, I don't know, you know, again, Wes kind of like established what this feels like by doing something so straight ahead, center justified, solid color, sans serif font, like, you know, it's interesting in what it is associated with by proxy, I guess, but, you know, like reading this quote, unstoppable, like nothing you've ever read before, it's like, all right, I wouldn't assume that looking at the cover here, but like,
well, would you assume that if we told you that the book is 1,000 pages long?
Yeah, and I mean, think about that, like if you're in a bookstore, like that tells you a lot about it, you know, just as much as a cover would. Like, you know, you think about, these are products on a shelf, essentially, and like everything that goes into it tells the story of, it's all technically part of the design. Like, you know, you're designing a book that is 1,000 pages, so it's going to look like a brick in hardcover or softcover, so you have a big fat spine, you know, and you can be, I guess, bold like this, because it's just like a big, thick thing.
I think it has a super classic look to it. Like it's a book whose cover like looks like it's already a classic, a book that's been around for 50 years.
And this only came out a year, what, 2 years ago?
Yeah.
Yeah. The word I was going to say, if I didn't say it already, was it's very confident. Like it's just a.
It's very
just
what? Say it again.
It's confident.
Oh yeah.
It's a confident design to be this simple, you know, and it's like you look below the water and you see that pretty like. Bold quote, like nothing you've ever read before. Booker Prize, and they have the little emblem in the upper right hand corner, whatever the, I guess Cory Booker gives that.
Yeah.
But
it's,
yeah.
It's for vegans from New Jersey.
Yeah, it is what it is. It just stands for itself, I guess. And you know, this is like I've seen a lot of book covers that look just like this, style wise. Like it's very much, it very much says book cover. Like maybe this could be like a poster for a I don't know, a play too or something. Mm-hmm. But it connotes like a high class experience you're about to get involved with. And you know, by that same token, you see a lot of dog shit stuff that looks like this too, because for that exact reason.
Yeah, it's trying to like imitate important art.
Matt, I will tell you that this book is unlike anything I've ever read before. It is unstoppable. I would not say unstoppable. Well, no, it's actually very stoppable. It's very easy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is this the best book you guys have read so far?
No.
It's Owen Meany still.
I always assume when I heard you guys mention the name of this book that that's a place.
So
is it a place?
So Newburyport, so I think, and this is, it's never explicitly described, but I think, so Newburyport is where her mother is from.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of mother talk in this book. And at one point when her mother was like a toddler, she like ran into a lake that she has chased after ducks and almost died. And I think the idea is like a place and the thing that like, it just could be like, you know, gun, comma, newcomer.
Yeah, it's the comma separating two separate clauses, but it's like mimicking a place by the just where it's chosen to, you know, bracket the sentences.
And a lot of the book is essentially like things that could almost be horrifically life-changing traumatic events that turn out to be nothing. And the fact that her mom almost drowned running after a duck and then didn't is just like one of those, like kind of like the first thing in her mother's life or something.
Yeah, pretty evocative title. Like it's been in the back of my mind ever since I've heard you guys mention it, just like randomly.
Oh, nice. Good going, yeah. Lucy Ellmann.
Two words down, 1,000 pages to go.
Well, she says it like 3 or 4 times, so like you're really like 6 or 8 words down, so yeah. you're much closer to the end.
We got one more thing that's really important, which is you're going to choose the Harrison Ford movie.
Oh, right. Yeah. So as a quick, so for our Patreon, which is patreon.com/lotterypod, in the off weeks when there's a movie that like ties in, like if there's a movie adaptation, but this week she references 3 different Harrison Ford movies so much. And I'm like, I need to watch all these movies soon. Cause like I've seen one of them like forever ago and I've never seen the other two. So Air Force One, The Fugitive, and Witness. Matt, I know that you voted for the candidate of your choice, but please, it was a tie on Twitter. Which of these movies should Bob and I watch tonight and then record a bonus episode for the Patreon?
I am a devout fan, and I would say that this movie is up there in maybe top, I might say top 10 action movies of all time.
Wow.
Harrison Ford, Dr. Richard Kimball, The Fugitive deserves as much attention and podcast hours as you guys are willing to give it.
Cool.
All right, you got it.
And I would have advocated for Air Force One too recently, but I watched that last summer and like, you know, it's all right. It holds up, but it's kind of dumb.
Wow, that was last summer. I remember talking about that like as a Zoom.
I know.
Unbelievable. I know. That was over a year ago.
I know. This is the second instance of something like that happened to me in 2 days. And I think last year was about 45 seconds long.
Yeah.
In total.
And also 45 years long.
Yeah.
What a weird thing.
So, yeah, Fugitive. Enjoy, guys.
Cool. All right. That's the one.
Similar to the title of this book, getting stuck in my head, one of my favorite lines in the movie is when he goes and he rents that basement apartment from the old Polish. I'm talking to Joey and Bob.
Hi.
Hey.
He's renting the basement apartment from the old Polish guy or the old Polish lady, and then her son is talking to the cops, and he's like, "Are you mean to tell me that Dr. Richard Kimball is renting this basement apartment from your mother?" And he leans back, he's all scumbaggy looking like Polish immigrant guy, and he goes, "That's what I'm telling you." it's like my favorite line from the whole movie.
So
when that comes across in like 2.5 hours, think of
it. you think instead of it being called The Fugitive, it should have been called That's What I'm Telling You?
Yeah, and you could put that guy on the poster. The other funny thing about The Fugitive is like Harrison Ford has this giant beard in the beginning of it, and it's just 100% so that he can shave it off and like change the way he looks later in the movie. Like, it's so stupid.
Well, I just watched the final Pierce Brosnan Bond movie, Die Another Day, and like he spends 15 months in a North Korean prison, like a prison, and like he's just got like, you know, the beautiful Pierce Brosnan like shoulder length hair and like this like gorgeous beard or whatever. Also that he goes back to a hotel after he's like escapes and they just like cut to him like finishing up the shave and he looks like Pierce Brosnan again. It's just like, yeah, of course, like we knew that. It wasn't, he wasn't gonna be like a raggedy Bond for the entire movie, even though that would have been better.
Yeah, that movie sucks.
I saw the opening sequence to that Bond. It's the only part of it that I saw. Really, it's very racist.
Oh yeah, like, it's not great. Also, I will tell you,
against using North Korea as like a movie bad guys thing, but like it did seem pretty bad.
The kind of the emotional through line for that is that one of the North Korean general's sons does like a body swap, mind swap into the body of a white man. And like, he's just like, that's part of the story. And like, it's just, father, don't you recognize me? He's like, I don't know who you are.
Oh, Pierce.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Matt. Right. I appreciate it. We got two more this season, so we're going to give you a call at some point soon. But this is another smash, rousing success story of Judge a Book by Its Cover with the Honorable Matt Erdely.
Wait, so is it guilty or not guilty? What's the verdict?
Yeah. Well, I'm glad you came up with something, because I had listened to one of your episodes recently, and I guess there was a promise that I'd come up with a rating scale, and I never actually did do
that. Well, feel free.
I like guilty or not guilty.
But you okay, so here's either guilty or not guilty, but of anything that you want it to be. So, like, at the end of every episode, Bob says, like, you know, today's crime is whatever. You can just pick whatever. It's guilty of something or not guilty of something.
Well, you know, given my, like, the template idea of the beginning that I said, I think that this book is mistrial on technicality.
Wow, okay. So the first time we have a rating, it's a mistrial.
All right. I like it.
Yeah, it's not, it didn't even, like, we're talking, like, 2 days in, some, like, inappropriately filed paperwork or something just rendered the whole thing tossed.
Someone didn't read someone the Miranda rights.
Yeah. Lazy law enforcing.
Wow. You heard it here first, folks. I don't know what you heard exactly, but you heard it here first.
It's a mistrial.
Here, I got a gavel type situation going. You read?
Perfect.
Yeah.
All right, Matt. Guys.
Have a good night, Matt. Have a good night, Violet, if you're still there.
She's not. All right, enjoy the fugitives.
All right, bye.
All right, is it email time?
It's email time.
Email crime.
Or do we want to talk about fantasy casting? I think it's just like, I kind of thought of my mom and then no one.
I don't think, first of all, it would have to be a first person perspective movie in order to mimic the style of it. And it would have to be perpetual voiceover for the entire thing. And then, I don't know, let's say Laura Dern.
Sure. Or you could also do Katie Mixon, who is the girlfriend, Kenny Powers' girlfriend in Eastbound and Down, because she's also in that show, American Housewife.
Yeah, okay.
You need to know the face that Bob made. Like, audio-wise, you could tell that he was upset, but, like, the face was just like, I can't believe I'm even justifying this with words. Also, the narrator never mentioned, like, never named, right?
I don't believe so.
At one point, she says the word Tuesday, and I'm like, oh, we're going to have, like, demarcations for time, and then never says anything like that again.
Yeah.
We have an email address, lottery@cageclub.me or lotterypod@cageclub.me if you want to write in. Even if you're listening now and you're like, oh, I really want to write in about Owen Meany or whatever, we'll read it on the next episode. People have not done that yet, but, you know, you still can.
Yeah, we'll find, you know, when people find this in 2024.
When we're on season 37, they're going to get real short. They're going to get really short. Okay. This season is about Ducks in Newburyport. This is from Jessica Collins, a.k.a. Montez, Ducks in Newburyport. Want to guess how she starts the email?
No.
The fact that.
Okay, sure.
if this phrase was taken from the book, would be about 145 pages. The fact that listening to this book read by Alexa was pretty hilarious. The fact that my brain could not have handled reading this more than 50-plus pages that I managed. The fact that I really enjoyed the section with the lioness. The fact that I related very hard to this character, her anxiety, and her stream of consciousness. The non-annoying bulleted version of the above. So she just actually rewrites.
Well, she actually is doing a thing that's like a classic, something that book reviewers do, which is like they review the book in the style in which the book is written. But now she's going to translate that for us. So
yeah, she said, if we remove the phrase "the fact that" from this book, it probably would have been about 145 pages. I mean, probably not that short, but like it probably would have saved 50 pages. Maybe there's probably 50 pages more than of that.
Probably more than 100.
Having Alexa read this book at 2x speed with no punctuation was hilarious, and I thought she may explode. What I did like about the audiobook reader, and not Alexa, but the woman who read it for Audible, especially after the Stacy thing runs away, like, she gets emotional. She starts speaking more quickly. And, like, she is great. It's really good.
Yeah.
My brain hurt the 50-plus pages I actually read of this, so an award to the rest of you that actually physically read this.
Just you. Oh, and Meg.
Yeah, I would have kept reading, but I was just like, I'm going to go on a walk. I'm going to listen to some ducks or whatever. But, yeah, I think there's rewarding elements to both. I think that there's...
For sure.
I really enjoyed the section splitting with the lioness. Yep. As someone with pretty severe anxiety, I really related really hard to this character's stream of consciousness, her anxieties, the things she worries about, her thoughts, all of it, except for the part about feeling sorry for her husband when he doesn't pack a suitcase till the morning of a trip. My husband does this, and I have zero feelings of sadness or empathy toward him. Thanks for the recommendation, guys. I'm looking forward to following along more religiously in the future. Glad to speak to you all a few weeks ago, too. Oh, yeah, I forgot. We had a exclusive summit with some of our, basically the people who have written to the show. And we decided the next season's theme, which we are not announcing yet.
Yeah.
We will in a few episodes. But Montez was there.
There was some discussion about the next season's theme just being horniness.
No, not horniness. Just horny.
Horny books, yeah. Books that are horny.
Yeah.
That's not it. We decided against that.
Yeah, because you said it's either all empowering from women or just all icky stuff from dudes.
Yeah. Yeah. Plus, I'd have a hard time podcasting with an erection.
Here for all the book discussions whenever you need a fellow bibliophile to join in. Much love from Virginia Montez. Thank you, Montez.
Oh, she's in Virginia?
Yeah. It is for lovers. Or is that West Virginia?
I think it's West Virginia. You fool.
And then we got Egg's reaction to Duck's Newburyport. Sent in 5 hours ago, really cutting it under the wire.
I think like 2 days ago, she was like, I have 500 pages left. And she just like buckled down and read.
Well, that was like why you're like, oh, you're making really good time with the book or whatever. I'm like, if I don't, I'm not going to finish this book.
Yeah.
Or we're going to record this podcast. Like I'm going to have to, you know, it's going to be like bang, bang, bang at the end or whatever. But also like what I liked about the structure is like I would literally set like I'm going to read 10 pages and I'm going to come back later and read 10 more pages. And like no matter when it stops, I'm just like, I can stop.
Yeah.
Like sometimes you're in the middle of a thing, but it's also like doesn't really matter.
Right.
Egg says I honestly wasn't sure if I was going to finish the book in time, but I'm so glad I did. I was still planning on writing in and using my email mostly to complain about how Bobby forced me to read this dumb book. That being said, I feel like this book was worth it for the last 50 or so pages when Ronnie came in with the gun. So this is direct opposition to you.
Yeah, that's true.
I audibly gasped. And was shaking during the time that the story was being told. It felt like Owen Meany in the way that she literally spent the entire novel setting up, but I still didn't see it coming. I really love it when books make me involuntarily react like that. However, I also feel like the parts immediately after Ronnie coming inside the house didn't happen. This narrator has spent 1,000 pages talking about her shitty memory, and then this really traumatic event occurs, and she's able to think about so clearly in a more or less narrative fashion 2 weeks after the fact. The very end part felt like a novel was finishing up in a way that no other part of the book felt, quote, like a novel.
Yeah, see, we agree. That's that's my point exactly.
Like, it felt like the narrator was then aware of the audience, and so she wanted to tell a good story to finish out the book, which I definitely appreciated, but I didn't really believe. I also do not believe the, quote, unquote, rescue by Stacy and the way they tied him up with clothes. It was too perfect. I liked it, but again, I don't think it really ended like that. In conclusion, thanks, guys, for making me read this book. Without this podcast, I never would have made it more than 30 pages in.
Nice.
So I think a couple ways to sort of, again, devil's advocate. I don't think we need to defend it, but, like, just because you remember a thing happening doesn't mean that it actually happened that way.
That's true.
Like, he might have been, like, flailing or whatever. Like, it seems like they're, like, they kind of conquer him perfectly, right? Like, the very end of Death Proof, where like they all, the three women all beat the shit out of Kurt Russell. Like that feels like an idyllic, like that's not, maybe not how it happened, but like it's how they remember, how they choose to portray it or whatever, right?
Like in what Meg's saying, like I think it does do that postmodern thing of like it feel, it's artifice, right? So it's like reminding us that it's a book. In wrapping it up and tying it all up together, it's like, well, it did happen that way. It happened that way because that's the way that it's written, because this is not a real thing that happened. And it's so like tying it up like that is saying, like, reliable narrator or not, this is what happened because you're reading a book.
I think there's enough stuff that is of a similar ilk to that that we talked about, like her correcting herself or her doing like cutesy sort of parallel structure, stylistic things that make it all sort of feel novel-ish in a way that like the ending doesn't feel wildly out of place. Like, I think that there's definitely merit and it's valid what you guys are saying, and I don't disagree, but I think that there's enough stuff earlier that it's not like this is the only time it felt like a novel or that she was telling this to someone.
Right. Fair enough. I'll take it.
If you want to email in lottery@cageclub.me, we're also at LotteryPod on Twitter and on Patreon. We got the Audible thing. I would say just bang for your buck, and also just in terms of the quality, get this as an audiobook. Like, don't get one that's going to take like 6 hours to read. Where's the value
exactly
there?
Yeah, get like one that's 45 hours and then listen to it on your commute every day.
Yeah, because you do get like lost into this world, which is also just our world, which also maybe you don't want to get lost into because it's very depressing and bleak, but also, you know, I think it's worth it. Instead of saying keep reading
Bond, you're going to use a misogynist slur.
But it's said by a woman.
Yeah, but you're not a woman. Go ahead. Say it.
Can't.
Say it. Say it and be the villain.
At the end. At the end of James Bond's Die Another Day.
Today's crime is lying to a police officer. Thank you and goodbye.